What is the secret for becoming rich? And can I make money in a difficult economy? And are there any hints or advice in the Torah? There's a story in the Torah about Yitzchak. That Yitzchak came to Gerar. And there in Gerar it says, Vayimsa bashana ahi mea sha'arim, that in that year he made 100 times the amount that all the analysts of that time predicted. And now she tells us, what was the secret? How was he able to make 100 times the amount, more than all the analysts at that time predicted? And furthermore, it was a difficult time. There was a famine in the land. The economy was terrible. And furthermore, the land which he lived upon was a very, very bad quality of earth. And yet he became so rich that the people of that time say, we would rather have the fertilizer of Yitzchak than the gold and the silver of the king of Avimelech. And Rashi tells us what was the secret behind his success. It was very simple. He gave charity. He gave 10% of everything that he made. And so I would like to discuss the mitzvah of tzedakah and the secret of tzedakah and the mystery of how one can truly become very rich. And to do this on 5 levels of pshat, remez, drush, soid, the simple level, and then the hint and the homiletics and the esoteric and also the Hasidic level. We start with the mitzvah of the Rambam. The Rambam tells us there's a mitzvah based on Deuteronomy 14:22, Aser ta'aser eis kol tevuah zarecha, that a person has the obligation to tithe 1/10 of the seeds of his crop. And furthermore, it says in Deuteronomy 15:8, ki pesayach tiftach es yadcha, that you shall surely open your hand and give the poor man tzedakah. And the Rambam writes that this is a halacha, this is a mitzvah, positive commandment 127, and also positive commandment 195, and that is that we are commanded to give charity to support and relieve the poor. What is the meaning of tzedakah? The simple meaning of tzedakah, as the Rebbe tells us, is not charity. Charity means that I have a lot of money, and you have less money than I have, and I feel bad for you, I have rachmanis. Rachmanis is not charity, that's called mercy, it's kindness. Tzedakah means the right thing. Tzedakah comes from the root, tzedek. Tzedek, tzedek, tirdoif, you shall pursue justice, to do the just thing, the right thing. The right thing is to give at least 10% to charity. Why? The first thing is that the money is not yours. All the money belongs to God. And God gives you money in order that when a poor person comes, you should give that poor person the money that belongs to him. And by giving that poor person the money that belongs to him, then God allows you to keep the other money. So you're doing the right thing. Number two is God owes you nothing. So why should God give you money in the first place? So when God sees that you go extend yourself and you go beyond yourself and you give your hard money that you worked for with sweat and blood, and you take this hard-earned money and you give it away to someone else, you say, God, look, I gave away mine to someone who's less fortunate than myself. You, God, give me back some money. So that is the meaning of tzedakah. You're doing the right thing. That's the pshat, that's a simple interpretation. And we are told that God generally pays you back 5 times the amount, and sometimes 10 times the amount, etc., etc. The remez, the hint. We are told that when Mashiach will come, no longer will there be any poor people in the world. There will be no poor people amongst you. And therefore, to hasten the coming of Mashiach by giving tzedakah now, and making sure that there are no poor people, we begin to live in this era of Mashiach. Furthermore, the Gemara tells us in the tractate of Baba Basra, G'dayla tzedakah shemekareves az ha-ga'ula. How great is tzedakah? Tzedakah is so great that it brings about the redemption. So this is the remez. By giving charity now, it reminds us there will come a time that we will no longer have to give charity because everybody will have money. Durush, what's the homiletics? So the Gemara tells us in the tractate of Tainis, on the verse that we read earlier, Asa to Asa, you shall surely give a tithe and give a tithe, which by the way, the commentaries explain, give a tithe twice, which means 1/20, 20%, or rather 1/5 of your money. Says the Gemara, why does it say this double terminology, Aser to Aser? Says the Gemara, Aser bishvil tis asher. If you want to become rich, tithe your money. And the Gemara goes on to say, even though generally a person is not allowed to challenge God, we're not allowed to give God a test. And we know King David unfortunately said, God, test me, and King David failed. So we're not allowed to ask for tests. But yet God says here, when it comes to charity, God tells us, and he bases this in a verse of Malachi, it says, "Uvchanuni na bezois." God says, test me when it comes to this. I dare you. I want you to test me. And by testing me, I will pay you back many times over. And therefore, even though normally we don't test God here, God demands of us we should test him. And he begs us. He requests of us, please, test me so that I will show you and give you back all these blessings. And then, yuverechacha, as we say in the priestly blessing, God will bless you with money, vishmerecha, and he will protect your money. That the money will not be lost, God forbid, through thieves, or through crashes, or God forbid, to be used on doctor bills. But rather, the money will be used for good things, for bar mitzvahs, and weddings, and happy occasions. We find many letters of the Rebbe pertaining to tzedakah. And the Rebbe quotes from Mishlei, which says that Malve Hashem Chenein Dal. When a person gives charity to a poor person, in essence, that person is lending God money. If you lend God money, God pays you back. And furthermore, it says also in the book of Mishlei, in the book of Proverbs, in chapter 22, the Eved Loive Leish Malve, that the borrower becomes a slave to the lender. So if we are lending God money, God has to listen to us. And the Alter Rebbe brings this down as a halacha, not only as a theoretical thought, but this is a true halacha in Agedas HaKedish. The Alter Rebbe brings it down in the Tanya, that this is a reality, and therefore by the fact that a person gives charity to the poor, that God, Ugumulla Yishalim, like God will surely pay the person back at least double and triple. The Rebbe quotes from the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe, Rabbi Yosef Yitzchak, that once a person makes a resolve to give money to charity, even though the person does not have the money, and does not see any way that he will have that money, by making that true, strong, firm resolution that I want to give $1,000,000 to tzedakah, all of a sudden new channels open up, and God gives you the opportunity to be able to give that tzedakah. And furthermore, the Rebbe says that by giving that tzedakah, then God will give you at least 4 times the amount. In other words, if you give 1,000,000, you'll have 5,000,000. We find, as I mentioned earlier, many letters of the Rebbe pertain to tzedakah. A fellow writes to the Rebbe that for some reason this year he made less money than last year. So the Rebbe tells him, perhaps you gave less tzedakah this year than last year. If you go back in your books and you'll analyze your books and you'll calculate them properly, you'll see that you gave less tzedakah the year before. So by going back and giving more tzedakah, you'll make more money. To another person, the Rebbe says, being that when you write a check for tzedakah, God pays you back at least 5 times the amount. So don't have rachmanis on God. Don't have mercy on God. Why do you write such a small check? You're having mercy on God. You don't trust God. You feel bad for God. Don't worry. God could fulfill his pledge. You write a bigger check and God will give you back much more. The Gemara tells us that money needs salt. By putting salt onto your money, in other words, by tithing your money, that will flavor the money and that will give you back many times over the money that you give for tzedakah. Furthermore, by giving charity 10% or 20% of your earnings, you're making God a partner in your business. A partner has interests. He wants to make sure the business is good. We are finite people and we make mistakes, but God is not finite. So by resolving to give at least 10-20% of your money to tzedakah, you have now a good partner. And therefore, surely you're going to be successful in your business. There's an amazing letter from the Rebbe from the 4th of Adar, Tavshin Yud Gimel. And the Rebbe writes as follows, and he puts it all together. He says, first and foremost, obviously the Rebbe was talking to a fellow who was very wealthy and was not fulfilling his pledge. The Rebbe said as follows, first and foremost, we find in many holy books that God is the one who is zon umefarnes lakol. God is the one that gives food and sustains everybody. Everything comes from God and only from God. And number two, we have to have emunah, we have to have faith to believe that everything we have in the world is from God. And it's not our minds, it's not our intellect, it's not our brains, our ingenuity that brings about this wealth. Is totally from God. And therefore, what happens is, because God likes to give people merits, he wants to give you a zuchus, a merit, many times God will give the money of person number A, or organization number A, to person number B. And person B has the money of person number A, and organization number A. So when Mr. A, or organization A, comes to Mr. B, Mr. B gives now the organization A, or the person A, back his money, which is 10 or 20% of your earnings. Now, the Rebbe goes on to say that above in heaven, they analyze this person. Is he the right guy for the job? Should he be the one holding everybody's money and then distributing the money to them, or should it be the other way around? So how did they analyze if this person is the right person for the job? Number one is they see if this person acknowledges his wealth. If he acknowledges that all the money that he has is truly from God and is God's money, that's the first thing they look for. The second thing is they look for is he fulfilling his mission? Is he making sure when Mr. A or organization A comes to him for tzedakah, he gives them tzedakah properly with a smiley face and he encourages them and he's happy to do it, not doing reluctantly like, okay, here's the money, take the money and go. And by doing that, not only does God bless him that he becomes the philanthropist, that he has the mitzvah of distributing the wealth, but he also has side benefits. He's able to have a nice house, he's able to have a nice car, he gets all the additional packages that come along with this mitzvah of tzedakah. What happens is the Yetzer Hara is very smart. The evil inclination moves in. He doesn't want, number one, the Jew to do the mitzvah of tzedakah. It's a big mitzvah, it's going to bring Mashiach. Number two, he doesn't want the man to live too well. Why should he have a nice house, a nice car? So the Yetzer Hara says, number one, you should know, you know why you have so much money? Because you're so smart. You went to Harvard and you went to Yale and you worked so hard on your business 24 hours a day. You even worked on Shabbos to make your money. That's why you're so loaded. That's why you have so much money. And the other guy has no money because he's a yokel. The guy has no brains. He's not too smart. That's why he has no money. But you have all the money because you're brilliant. So it's the right thing as an American to give a few dollars to somebody else. It's the right thing. You don't have to give them too much, but to give them something. Share them a few pennies, a few cupcakes, a few nickels. But don't overdo it. Don't get carried away with tzedakah. Number two is, if the guy will respect you and lick your feet and say, oh, you're mamish God yourself, you're giving me so much money, you give me life, then you continue to give him money. But if he doesn't come back and give you all this honor and glory and put your face all over his house and plaster your name all over his temple, forget about it. Don't give him any more money. That's the Yetzer Hara. So therefore, to prevent this mistake, every morning when a Yid gets up, what do we say? We say, Moida ani lefanecha. Thank you, God. I acknowledge you. Shechazarta bi nishmasi. You gave me back my soul, bechemla, with mercy. I understand that you gave me my soul with mercy. I understand I'm able to breathe with mercy. I understand that every nickel that I have, you gave me with mercy. And therefore, it's your money. And then we go on to say, in the Amidah, Ato chenin ladam das. We say, God, you give man knowledge. You give man brains. In other words, you give us the brains to understand that everything we have is from you. And therefore, when you have these two concepts, these two qualities, number one, you know the money is God's. And number two, you know you have the obligation, the mission of distributing this money, then you are blessed with all of this money. So this is the drush when it comes to the concept of tzedakah. What is the soid? What is the esoteric meaning of tzedakah? So we find in Tehillim, chapter number 112, it says over there, Pisa nosan lev yoinim. Sidkosay emedes lad. It says over there in verse of the Tehillim, chapter 112, that when a person gives money to the poor people, and he does this in an expansive way, then his righteousness is preserved forever. What does that mean? There's a beautiful teaching from the Arizal in the Soid, in the esoteric level of the Torah. He says an amazing thing. He says, you know, when you do a mitzvah, any mitzvah, and there are 613 mitzvahs in the Torah, every time you do a mitzvah, each mitzvah is connected with a different letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Some are connected with the Aleph, and others are the Beis, and Dalit, and Vav, and Yud, and Chaf. When you do that mitzvah, on your forehead, that letter appears. And those people that have eyes that can see, holy tzaddikim, righteous people, can see on your forehead the mitzvah you just did based on the letter. But after you finish the mitzvah, the letter disappears. When you give tzedakah, says the Arizal, the letter stays on your forehead the entire week. And the Rebbe takes it a step further and says, la'ad, forever. Tzedakah is so powerful that it remains for you, with you forever. Then the Arizal goes on to say that we find, what does it mean that tzedakah will stand forever? So we know that there are two ways to read the Aleph Beis. There's from Aleph to Tav, which is the chronological order. And then there is also the Adbash, when you switch the first letter for the last letter. It's amazing that when you take the Adbash and you switch the Aleph for the Tav and the Beis for the Shin, etc., etc., the word tzedakah and Adbash is also tzedakah. For the Tzaddik gets switched for the Hay, the Dalit for the Kuf. So we have a Tzaddik becomes a Hay, the Dal becomes a Kuf, the Kuf becomes a Dalit, and the Hay becomes a Tzaddik. So you have tzedakah. Either way you look at it, you have the word tzedakah. For tzedakah, any way you turn it, it's tzedakah. It stands with you forever. And finally, the Arizal says an interesting thing, that the Kuf, in the word tzedakah, the Kuf goes beyond the baseline. The Kuf represents kina, represents jealousy. And therefore, by giving tzedakah, we transform that negative aspect of jealousy into something which is divine and holy. And that's the power of tzedakah, that it removes all negative influences and does not allow the powers of impurity to nurture from you. This is the esoteric aspect of tzedakah. And then we have the Hasidic interpretation, which is what the Alter Rebbe writes in Tanya in numerous places, that tzedakah is considered to be the greatest mitzvah of all other mitzvahs. What's the reason? Because when you do a mitzvah, let's say you walk to the shul. You're doing the mitzvah with your feet. When you do a mitzvah of studying Torah, you're doing it with your mouth and your mind. However, tzedakah, when you give one nickel, one dime to tzedakah, you're doing this mitzvah with all of your limbs and all of your arteries. How so? Because how did you make this money? You had a shvitz, and you had a toil, and you were up late nights, and you were crying, and you were thinking, and you were running, and you were screaming, and you were shouting, and you were tearing the hair out of your head from top to bottom. You were involved in creating this business, involved in creating this money. And now you take this hard-earned money that you ran for, and you worked for, and you lost sleep over, and you give this money away to somebody else. You elevate every aspect of your body. It's the greatest mitzvah. And that is why through tzedakah we bring about geula, we bring about the redemption. For redemption is about elevating the whole world. Furthermore, says the Alter Rebbe, that even though it says aser to aser, that you should give 10% or 20%, and the Gemara says don't give more than 20%, because it's a problem, you might lose your money. Yet the Alter Rebbe says in Tanya that a person is allowed to give more than 20%. Why? Because let's say, God forbid, you're sick, and you have to go to the doctor. And you go to the doctor, and the doctor says, you know what, I don't take any HMOs. I don't take any health insurance. You got to pay cash. And even though you have health insurance, it doesn't cover for all the problems that you have. What does a person say? Okay, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to forget about it. No. You'll mortgage your house. You'll give up your car. You'll sell everything to protect your life. The most important thing is life. You'll give up everything, all your money for life. Now, this is true for physical life, which is only finite of 70, 80, 90, and God willing, 120 years, and you're willing to give up all your money for your physical life and health, how much more so should a person be willing to give up his money for his spiritual health? Because your soul is eternal, lives on forever and ever. And therefore, to make sure that our soul will reach the highest levels of paradise, and that our soul will be able to truly be cleansed from this world. Therefore, if we do a mistake and we sinned in the past, it's not enough that we give 10% or 20%, but really a Baal Teshuva has to give even more than 20%. And by doing that, by telling God, look, I went out of my comfort zone. I went beyond my obligation. Now you go beyond your obligation. And you give me back more than that. So, on a practical level, on the level of action, what should we do? So the Rebbe says that in every kitchen in one's home, you should affix a tzedakah box, a pushka. It's not enough that you have it in the kitchen, but actually take a nail and put it onto the wall. And by doing this, you make your whole house into a bias of tzedakah, a home of charity. This will therefore enlarge your vessel for God's blessings. God willing, if you have children, in each child's room, there should also be a tzedakah box, not only in the room, but also on the wall of the room. And that will make that room into a cheder of tzedakah, a room of charity, a room of justice, and a room of kindness. And that will shower God's blessings upon your children. The Rebbe also mentions in letters to put a tzedakah box in a car. Yes, believe it or not, in your car, to have a charity box, and this will protect the car from theft and other things. Also, the Rebbe says it's important for Jews and non-Jews. Once a week, the boss should go around and distribute some change, a dollar or two, to all the workers that are working together with him, and they should give it to tzedakah, and hopefully they will also add on their own. My brother-in-law, Rabbi Adler in Florida, had a Baal Bus who once came to the Rebbe many years ago for dollars. And this fellow owned a big, large used car dealership. And the Rebbe gave him a dollar and said, put it into the pushka in your office. And the fellow told me that every time there was a slow day, he together with all the workers would come into the office, they would pull out their money, put a few dollars in the pushka, and all of a sudden the customers came from all sides. So by giving tzedakah, God gives you back. Immediately, you see the results. The Rebbe tells a story. This is told on Living Torah. There was a wealthy philanthropist who gave a lot of money to the yeshiva in California. And they brought him into the Rebbe. The Rebbe gave him a private yechidus. And there in the yechidus, the Rebbe saw that he was a bit ambivalent, you know, did he do the right thing? He gave so much money to the yeshiva. Was it the right thing or the wrong thing? So the Rebbe said, I want to tell you a story. There was a rabbi, and the rabbi had a drawer, and in the drawer he had money. And when people would come to his house, and they would ask the rabbi for tzedakah, you know, to marry off their children, or for a bar mitzvah, or whatever it was, the rabbi would open up his drawer and give out some of the money to tzedakah. One day a fellow came, and the rabbi took out all the money from the drawer and gave it to that person for tzedakah. The next morning, the wife finds out that the husband gave out all the money for tzedakah. So she tells her husband, the rabbi, Rabbi, why'd you do this? Why'd you give all the money for tzedakah? So the rabbi said, look, I had a dream last night. And in the dream, my soul ascended into paradise. And there in paradise, I saw how a rabbi dies, and he comes up to paradise, he's in the waiting room, and they asked him, what did you do in this world? Oh, I was a rabbi. What did you do? I studied Torah. Very nice, you studied Torah. That's very good. Yes, it's true, we know you studied Torah, but we still have to check you out. We got to go back to the computers, we got to go to the database, we got to see everything else you did besides the fact you studied Torah. And the rabbi had to wait there for a while until they were able to bring him into paradise. Another guy comes up, what did you do? Well, I did something else, I did this mitzvah. I davened every day three times a day, and I did a lot of other wonderful things. Okay, it's true, we see it on the scorecard. You definitely pray three times a day, a wonderful thing, but we got to still check you out. You got to wait here a little bit. We'll go into the database and see your whole life, all the things you did to make sure you're really worthy of going into paradise. And after a while, they came out and said, fine, come into paradise. The third guy comes up, and they say, what did you do? Oh, me? I was a philanthropist. Oh, yes, it's true, you were a philanthropist. Okay, come right on. Come right on in to paradise. They didn't make him wait. They didn't check out his database. You were a philanthropist? Come on in. And therefore, he told his wife, it's true, I might be a rabbi, and I pray three times a day, and I study Torah. But you know what? There's no greater mitzvah than tzedakah. There's no greater mitzvah than charity. So we hope and pray that all of us will take the tzedakah challenge. Give more than you can. Make a resolution to give a lot of money this year. Give it to the charity of your choice. No one is telling you where to give it. There are many, many charities and worthy charities. Give the tzedakah. Make a resolution. This year I'm going to give $1 million for tzedakah. And you'll divide it up between 12 months of the year. You'll start giving every month. And God willing, by the end of the year, you'll see that you have not only that $1 million back, but double and triple and quadruple, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 times the amount of money that you gave. And we hope and pray that through tzedakah, we will bring about health and remedy and blessing. And the true blessing of tzedakah, that tzedakah mekareves ha-geula, that tzedakah will bring about the redemption with the coming of Mashiach speedily in our days. Amen.